All right. Did you know that in 2013, the United States burned roughly 130 billion gallons of gasoline? And that's just 6% less than the high that was recorded in 2007. That was 140 billion gallons of gasoline. Hi, I'm Ben Corbett, and this is Michael Courier. We are here after doing extensive research to talk to you about a company called Fisker Automotive. We want to tell you a little bit about who Fisker is and why a company like Fisker is important to a green future in the automotive industry. We hope this presentation will help young people like yourselves become more interested in green technologies, especially in the automotive field where we burn so much energy, and that the common misconception that going green means compromising our energy usage and using less energy and getting less power, especially out of our vehicles, is not necessarily true. All right. During this presentation, you will hear a little bit about the history of Fisker Automotive, the present, and the technical benefits to a green future. Now I'll hand it off to Michael, and he'll tell you a little bit about the history.
Hi, I'm Michael, and I'll be telling you about the history of Fisker Automotive. So Fisker Automotive was founded in 2007, according to the website's timeline, by Henrik Fisker and Bernard Kohler. They got together with the goal of creating premium electric hybrid vehicles. And who is Henrik Fisker? According to Fortune magazine, he is one of the most successful car designers in the world. He worked at Aston Martin as a senior designer and was on the board. And Aston Martin is a very, very successful car designer company. Very prestigious. So when they started out, they had quite a bit of hurdles. They got their feet off the ground when they got the Department of Energy automobile loan. It was over $500 million they had to work with. But unfortunately, they kind of started to face obstacles. Their first was getting sued by Tesla. And even though they won that lawsuit, it was just to cover the financial and legal costs that it had cost them, which was like $1 million. And the Privco timeline of Fisker Automotive just details all of the like hurdles they went over. They had battery recalls and warranties they had to cover. In Hurricane Sandy, they lost over 300 million of their cars, and their insurance refused to cover it, so they had to settle an insurance dispute, which never got resolved. And eventually, the final stake in their death was the freezing of their loan from the Department of Energy. So we move on to the present. They got bought out by a Chinese company called Wangchang. Some say Wang Xiang, but according to an attorney who represents the company here, they go by Wangchang as the pronunciation. Well, according to Wangchang's website, they're a car parts and automobile parts manufacturer. And they bought Fisker because they want to advance and invest into green technologies for automobiles. They have a headquarters here in America, in Chicago, and they power the entire building with a solar farm they built that also feeds into the city. They state on their website that their goals are to continue the vision of Fisker Automotive, and that's just to keep continuing into green technologies and hybrid cars. They made plans to continue production of the Fisker Karma, which was Fisker Automotive's first and actual physical car that was sold. And now that I've caught you up to speed on where the company is, I'm gonna pass it over to Ben to tell you about the benefits of Fisker Automotive's technologies.
Okay. So I think the most important part about Fisker Automotive is that they set not only a good, but what I think is to be a realistic example for a transition into a greener automotive industry, you know, for everyday people just to drive cars. They're not insanely expensive. Though the Karma itself right now, because it's their first car, it's almost like a prototype, it is expensive. Their platform that they built the car off of, not like the body or the interior, but the actual drive platform, is really revolutionary, and it uses existing technology that we've already seen in cars like the Prius, or even, you know, hybrid Tahoes, hybrid Escalades, stuff like that. But what makes them more realistic, I think, for a change is that there's been this void in the continuing on and evolution of what is going to be our future car industry, which is going from gasoline to pure electric. Now, we said something about Tesla earlier, and the reason I'm going to use them as an example is because Tesla is the leading electric car company in the country right now. They have by far the best range, best horsepower for their vehicles, just all in all, better performance all around. Then let's say like a Nissan Leaf, which, I mean, it's very tiny and boxy, it doesn't look all that great, goes 90 miles, and you have to plug it in all night, and it's not effective. Which, again, brings me back to the void that has been set with this evolution. People are used to having their gasoline cars, and you know, you're going to work, you got 5 miles left, and you're on empty. 2 blocks later, you can pull into a gas station, fill up, and you're back to square one again. You can drive pretty much forever, as long as you have a couple bucks in your wallet. And I think the reason why we've had such a hard time transferring over to pure electric vehicles is because people don't like the feeling of not having that freedom. You don't want to, you know, people want to have time in their day to, you know, run errands, or what if you get called and you say, oh, can you come up to Dallas for the day? You don't want to have to think about, oh, let me charge my car for 12 hours before I do that. You want to be able to get in your car and go. And I think that that's where going back to a more of a hybrid model comes in. And people, the Prius has been around for 11 years now, 12 years, and it gets 50 miles a gallon. And I mean, it's a decent vehicle, but it's nothing too special. And the Fisker Karma is the perfect thing to build off of, I think, for our next, you know, vision of the hybrid vehicle. Even if Fisker's not building it, I think any car company could take this over, and I think it's a really, really good idea. And just to tell you a little bit about the differences between the Fisker hybrid and a regular hybrid, the Fisker hybrid, the gasoline engine just powers the battery, does not drive the wheels. And in a Prius, that's what happens. And you lose a lot of energy from the engine to the flywheel, transmission, differential, the wheels. You lose a ton of power in an engine. So going straight to the battery, you maintain top performance, top energy conservation, and you end up with a figure that's like 400 horsepower, which is the same as like a good, you know, turbocharged, supercharged muscle car, and you get 1,000 foot-pounds of torque, which is the same as a Bugatti Veyron, who, for those of you who don't know, is like, used to be the fastest streetcar in the world. So it opens up a huge possibility to the future, and if you can imagine, that's the first car that's really done this. 5 years from now, if you keep evolving that, I mean, what could you have every day for someone for 20 grand? You could put it in a Civic, and everybody would have the infrastructure in place to fill their car up, yet the green technology to get to work in a way where they're not guzzling gas. Anyway, I'm going to pass it back to Michael now for concluding our presentation.
So, to conclude, today we talked to you about the history of Fisker Automotive, the struggles they went, and the eventual bankruptcy. And we talked about the revival, how they're coming back, and how these technologies are going to benefit you, the consumers. So thank you all for attending, and are there any questions?